in a very powerful devotion. Let us pray most of all for the grace to imitate him in this, that is to say, to maintain our faith regardless of what people may say or speculate or think, because it is the truth. St. Anthony gives a wonderful example of that in his preaching of the Blessed Sacrament. The old heretic in Toulouse, Bonvillo, said it wouldn't be worthy for God to be present beneath the appearances of mere bread and wine. But then, of course, he made the challenge, and if my mule kneels down and adores at your Corpus Christi procession, then I'll believe. And after 3 days of prayer and penance, St. Anthony was able to obtain this miracle from Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament. So that was a popular idea, you see. There are all sorts of popular ideas that are always false. St. Anthony is the hereticorum malleus, we sing in the hymn. That is, he's a hammer of heretics. He just smashes them right down, and all heretical ideas. Remember that part of the keeping of the true faith is this idea: we don't care what people think. We care only what God thinks. We want to love our Lord and imitate all of the saints. So as they say, let us ask for this grace. Two other little baby examples, and then we go on to our devotion to conclude. Today we keep St. John Francis Regis, that great Jesuit missionary in southern France in the 17th century, to whose tomb the curate of ours, because he was desperate to get into a seminary and to be able to make his studies and be ordained a priest, made a very, very penitential and difficult pilgrimage. He thought he would bake his food, and everyone thought he was a very healthy-looking young man and was wondering why he wasn't working, so no one gave him any food. He had a very penitential time to get to the tomb of today's Saint John Francis Regis. Well, one of the things that our saint did, and truly had to go against the tide on this one, was to convert people who had fallen into a life of sin, women in particular, and then to provide for them. So he set up a whole sort of a social network of former sinners who had led a very sinful life, and he found them employment in visiting sick people, in visiting prisons, in making sure that no one got forgotten in all of these wonderful Catholic towns and in the Languedoc region of southern France. And at some point, his superior said, "Here now, people are talking about you. You can't be working with these people. They're not worthy. They're sinful. We shouldn't have anything to do with them," even though he had reformed them and taken each one through a very sincere confession, and they were in a state of sanctifying grace. And so his work was destroyed. And he accepted that with perfect equanimity and peace of heart, such as his great humility. But in time, he was vindicated, and everything was restored again. Last example, and a Eucharistic one, today is the feast day of St. Lutgard, the wonderful Belgian Cistercian sister. Remember, she's the one to whom our Lord appeared. She was training to be a nun, but was extremely worldly, and really hadn't made up her mind that she wanted to be a nun, and she was with a friend in the parlor, and our Lord appeared to her with his Sacred Heart, and he said to her, "Pay attention to me, love me," which every now and again our Lord probably wants to do for each one of us, because we get distracted with many false loves, don't we? "Pay attention to me, love me." And so she did. She had that sort of a mystical crown of thorns under her veil. We just see the blood come down. And that she suffered the rest of her life very sweetly. Well, at that time, it was not common to go to communion. And while the rules of the Cistercian order permitted the sisters to approach through the Blessed Sacrament every Sunday and feast day, the sisters didn't. It was a bad habit, a custom, a kind of a prejudice. Again, the idea we're not worthy. And St. Lutgard was called by our Lord, and if she didn't go, our Lord would get after her and say, "Come to me, you come to communion." And so she did, and the altar was very far away from the nun's choir. And it was a long, lonely walk, she used to say, up that aisle. And everybody was looking at her and saying to themselves, "Harumph, now who does she see as she is? She's going to communion. We're not going to communion." But our Lord made her. And so she went to communion. She spurned the public popular prejudices and the thought, the opinions of others. There's no way that we can do God's will today. There's no way that we can be good Catholics tomorrow unless we have this spirit. Remember St. Anthony the Hammer, of heretics. But you have to hammer down, too, all those popular presuppositions that allow heresy to intimidate others and to flourish. that Anthony, I know, will help us in this.